And what do I want here? I want a view. I want to see you guys. So how can I see you guys? Oh, there you are. Okay. That was weird. I had one window behind another. All right. Well, it's 7:30, so let me officially say welcome everyone to the astronomy section of the Rochester Academy of Science March monthly meeting. My name is Mark Minerich, president of the astronomy section. So welcome everybody. We've got people not just from the astronomy section here tonight, but we have folks from probably from the Buffalo Astronomical Association. So welcome folks from Buffalo, as well as the Mohawk Valley Astronomical Society. So we may see some of those folks drop in as well. So welcome to our meeting. In this crazy world, we've been able to find that sharing our resources allows us to have a lot more in the way of astronomy for those that are interested in it by sharing these talks. So thanks everybody for coming. All right, so it's March. My image today on our presentation, I always like to put some kind of new image for the background. Anybody know what this is in the background of the banner slide I have here? What is this? Go ahead and say it if you know what it is.
Ladies.
No, it's not it's the Southern Cross. Don got it. Yeah. Southern Cross. And then off to the left of the Southern Cross are two of the closer stars to us, Alpha and Beta Centauri. Centaurus kind of wraps around the Southern Cross. So this is just a stellarium screen capture. It wasn't an image. No. All right, so welcome everybody. We did our welcome, we'll have announcements. And then our feature talk is by Don Feiger, who's the director of the Center for Detectors at the College of Science at the Rochester Institute of Technology. So welcome, Don, glad to have you here. So is there anybody here that this is the first astronomy section meeting you've ever been to?
Hi, this is my first meeting. My name is Larry Roth. Excited
Hi, Larry.
To be here. Hey.
How'd you find out about us, Larry?
I actually, my friend Tim Haywood is sitting here as a member. And also, I think I was over at the property when there was the Iona Tractor Fest or Tractor Parade, you know, more than a couple years in a row. So, yeah.
Yeah. Get a nice tour of the facility on days like that. Well, welcome. Glad to have you here.
Thank you. Nice to meet everybody.
Anybody else? The first astronomy section meeting? I see Devin from Buffalo
here. Mark, this is Craig Kaplan. There's somebody named Susan Comer who's considering joining, who may be in the audience tonight. I'm not sure if she is or not, but I, without putting her on the spot and asking her to say anything, I'd like to welcome her as a possible member if she is on the call.
Awesome. Thanks, Craig. All right. Well, I won't put anybody else on the spot. Thanks for everybody who's here. Glad you guys could make it. Have we done any observing recently? I actually went through I go through the emails to put an image up on this slide for somebody that might have shared an image with the group, and there was none in the last month. Nothing new anyway. So Devin says with binoculars only. So you braved the cold and went out in binoculars. I actually went out last night and tried to do a little test with our C-14. We wanted to try to do a virtual Messier marathon. And so I want to make sure I could stream. And so I went out there to take a look at it. And it was very cold, but it was very, very pretty out last night, early in the evening. Jackie chats that she saw the crescent moon on the walk this evening. But no serious astronomy, it looks like, we've had in the recent month, which I get it. It's cold. It's hard to do that. And Venus was a lot of fun for the last month, but not so much fun now. All the planets are real close to the sun right now. All right. So I thought it appropriate that we recognize Judy Pfeiffer. She was actually supposed to be our speaker this evening, and we had talked to Judy months ago to come and give us a talk on her expertise, which is infrared photography. She's the grand dame, if you will, of infrared photography. She's a professor emerita of physics and astronomy at U of R. She's taught there from 1971 to 2002. Well, she passed away on February 21st at the age of 81. And she'd actually done several talks for us in the past, but she bowed out of the March talk a few months ago. In fact, I think it was like November when she had her pancreatic cancer diagnosis. She wasn't sure that she was going to be able to do this and should be fighting this. But unfortunately, she lost that battle a couple of weeks ago. So for those of you who don't know who Judy was, she was pretty exceptional. She was inducted into the National Women's Hall of Fame in 2007 for the advances she made in the study of astronomical objects by observing stuff in infrared. Dan Watson has a quote for her, and I'll give you guys a link later on in the chat, some of the accomplishments she's made. But Dan Watson says that she was considered the mother of infrared astronomy, and in many senses, motherhood. She created the technology that enables us to do the observations we can do today. And she used that technology herself to create important contributions in several frontier areas of astrophysics. And through her directly nurturing her close by junior colleagues and serving as a beacon more widely, she contributed mightily to the creation of two generations of astrophysicists. So, lastly, she was the director for the Mies Observatory for a number of years from 79 to 94. She played a large role in revising the undergraduate astronomy courses to use that telescope. So I wanted to recognize Judy Pfeiffer and how significant she was. And we've actually had her several times at talks here for the astronomy section. So wanted to make sure we gave her that recognition. So sorry to hear that she passed so quickly after her pancreatic cancer diagnosis. Anybody else want to share anything about Judy?
Yeah, Mark, I don't know if anybody had the chance to work with her, but she had a terrific attitude about just about everything.
Yep, no doubt. No doubt. I didn't get to work with her personally. I did get to speak with her at a couple of meetings, but that was just talking about her talks and the stuff that she was doing at U of R.
She visited the planetarium a couple of times with classes.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, we'll miss Judy. And I think this is a great picture of her with all her infrared photometry stuff. Kind of cool.
Yeah, she was a gem. You know, she just, with all the contributions she made to science and her community and all that stuff, she was just down to earth and approachable when she came to our meetings. You know, you would never know that she was a giant in the field, the way she treated everyone.
It was like talking to an aunt or a cousin or somebody.
Exactly.
It was exactly very approachable. Yeah, wonderful person. We'll miss her. We'll miss her very much. Okay. So coming up, we're supposed to have a Messier marathon tomorrow, but the forecast is not very good for a Messier marathon tomorrow. It looks like it's going to be almost completely socked in. So, and I was actually going to try to do a virtual marathon as we were going as well, but the dome was actually frozen for me last night. I couldn't open it. That's not to say that if it got warm and we could open it back up, the ice melted, or if I pried it apart. But we'll do another one. We'll do a virtual Messier marathon along with the Messier marathon. I think the rain date, if you will, is the first dark weekend in April, which I think is April 2nd. We'll try to do it then, if not sometime in the next week or so. And then we have an open house on Sunday, but the forecast for that isn't very good either, is it, Roger? We have rain for Sunday. I put Roger on the spot.
Yeah, there's rain.
I gotta unmute myself. Yeah, it doesn't look good Sunday.
we're supposed to have warm rain.
So we have that going for us. Anyway, it's March. What do we expect? Well, it's there if it happens to be a nice day. Also coming up, we're going to do a supernova imaging session. And I tried to book Tuesday. It looked like a good day. You can see that that's X out right now. We would be using the MEES telescope to do to show you how we would do supernova imaging on that scope. And right now there are a couple of students that have to complete projects. So they're observing H2 regions. I think there's people at the MEES scope tonight, and there will be, they already have it reserved for Tuesday. So Kelly Douglas, who's the director now for the MEES telescope, has told me asked me to hold off till another date. So we'll wait and see when we can get to a supernova, but there is one right now just east of Orion. So it's fairly early in the evening. So we could actually do the supernova imaging session fairly early in the evening if we get the opportunity in the next few weeks. So we'll keep our fingers crossed. The whole idea would be to show how we would do actual scientific imaging. So you get the proper exposure length and such to capture a supernova, and you could tell what magnitude that is based on nearby stars. So stay tuned. Also coming up 2 weeks from tonight, we like to do some winter lecture series because there's not much to observe and not much else to do. We try to give a couple of lectures during the course of the year. We did one a couple weeks ago with Dan Watson talking about that MEES telescope. And in 2 weeks, we have two of our members that have a couple of talks to give us. Bob Easterly has a talk about the inner space race. This is the early space race about the Russians, United States, the early days before NASA. Bob's got a talk about half an hour, 40 minutes on that. And then Marty Pepe has a talk called the HSK and You Are Made of Star Stuff or something like that. Besides Marty, I just told a bunch of you guys because you started early. Anybody else know what the HSK is?
No takers, huh?
No takers. Marty, what's the HSK?
I'm not going to release it now.
No?
You're going to have to tune in a couple of weeks.
All right. Stay tuned. If you look it up, it might be hard to find. It's cartoon related. All right. That's in a couple of weeks.
Thanks for the billing.
Absolutely. And then in April, our meeting in April is literally the first day of April, April Fool's Day, and we'll be back at RIT then, and we'll have speakers. Our speakers will be, I think, at least three of Dr. Richmond's grad students. Oops, I didn't mean to do that. Give me a second here. At least three of Dr. Richmond's grad students, and I was trying to pull up their talks. The students are Sadie Kaufman, who's going to give a talk on measuring the expansion of Kepler's historic supernova remnant, and what could we learn from the remnant, remains of an exploding star. Drittrapan Lertprasatong, and I totally butchered his name. Drittrapan Lertprasatong, and we'll make him say it, about galaxy formation and cosmic noon. It's even though the astronomers still don't have sufficient understanding of galaxy formation in the present day, the advancement of multi-wavelength astronomical surveys has progressed our view of star formation, galaxy evolution, and the reionization of the universe up to approximately 40 million years after the Big Bang. So we'll explore some of the galaxy evolution. Ben Vaughn has a talk called The First Extrasolar Light of Time. And time is the tomographic ionized carbon mapping experiment. It's to create a scanning spectrometer that can observe large patches of sky in radio. So we'll hear a little bit about that. And the fourth person's talk is TVA. It's Sophia Valentina Fisella. And we'll hear about what her talk is when they get here. So each of these students are grad students, and eventually they're going to have to defend their papers and present them, and this gives them an opportunity in front of an astronomically educated, if you will, audience to do some of that talking. So we look forward to having those students talk to us, and it's at our host organization or our host place at RIT for the wintertime. So we look forward to that. In May, we'll be back at the Ferris Center, and we'll be have Dave Bishop's annual and most popular astronomy year in review. And Dave, I hear Dave has completely updated that. So we'll find updates on some of the things we heard from last year, and then so all new stuff. So we'll look forward to Dave's talk. You got a lot of new stuff, Dave? I put him on the spot.
Oh, yeah. Some really cool stuff, too. And some stuff you won't believe.
Oh, no kidding.
Oh, yeah. Like the Chinese archway on the moon.
Archway? Really?
Yes.
All right.
Don't worry. It's only a rock.
I don't believe. All right. And then in June, we're going to have joint meetings with the Buffalo Astronomy Association. We'll host the Buffalo group in Rochester on the first Friday of the month. And then the second Friday of the month, the Buffalo Astronomical Association will be hosting us. So we'll look forward to a little cooperative stuff happening in June. So I believe that's all. Oh, wait, I got a couple more quick announcements. One is to save the date for a Rochester Star Fest. That's July 22nd, 23rd. 22nd is a Friday, 23rd is the Saturday that most of the events will happen. We don't have a speaker yet for that, but we hope to announce that very shortly. And for that event, we are having a t-shirt contest. So we're looking for a t-shirt design for Rochester Star Fest 2022. And if you submit the winning design, you get free admission, dinner, and a t-shirt to the event. Send your design to my email. And our preference is for one color, maybe two color designs, something line art-ish, something that's pretty simple to reproduce. And you need to send it by the end of the month or by April 1st, because that's when the board will get together and we'll decide on who the winner is, so we can get in process of printing up those shirts. So we've had some submissions so far, a lot of really nice looking stuff. So we should have a pretty nice shirt, but looking forward to seeing all of your submissions for that. Finally, it's time to renew your membership. All of our memberships, if we did not renew for 2021, expired in December, on December 31st. And we've typically given people grace until March 31st to catch up. So that date is rapidly approaching, and you don't want to lose access to these meetings and to the newsletter, the site, all the things that we have access to as a astronomy section member. So please renew at your earliest opportunity. Pretty easy to renew. If you want to just send an email to membership at our website at rochesterastronomy.org. Craig Kaplan's our membership chair. He'll answer your requests, get you a form. He can get you all renewed up. You don't need to send him a check. If you don't want to do that, you can do it all through PayPal. You could do it all electronically. So make it happen. Any questions on renewal or new members? And then finally, if you, every member has access to the site, so you get a combination to the lock at the bottom of the gate to get you into the site. You could observe, you could bring your own equipment. Other people are there, you can use all the equipment on the site, but as a key holder, you have access to the buildings. You can open up the roll-offs to access those telescopes, including a 12-inch Newtonian, a 20-inch Dobson, a 17-inch Dobson, a 14-inch Schmidt-Cassegrain, two 12-inch Schmidt-Cassegrain. There's all kinds of nice scopes, and a whole loaner scope program that you could take scopes home for a couple of months at a time. Most of those are 6-inch Dobsonians, have a couple of 10-inch Dobsonians, some Schmidt-Cassegrains. So all that stuff's available to you as a member, and as a key holder, you have access to those scopes that are on site. So to become a key holder, you need to be a member in standing for at least 2 years. And let us know that you're interested in being a key holder. We'll get you a key to the site, and we'll talk about all the rules and regulations for holding a key. It's nice to have. You can go out there whenever you want. Skies are fairly dark out there, so it's a great spot to get set up. You don't have to bring your equipment down if you want to use the stuff that's there, or you can bring your equipment down either way. Any questions on keys, key holders? All right. That's all I have. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Don Feiger, who's the director of the Center of Detectors for the College of Science at RIT. So I will stop sharing somewhere here.
Okay. Thanks very much, Mark.
Yes.
I'm going to share my screen. And there we go. Can you all see that?
Yes.
Let me, I forgot to tick off the sound. I want sound. There we go. Now, how's that? Good?
That's good.
Okay, great. Well, thanks, Mark, and everyone else for inviting me to talk with you tonight. It's a pleasure to do so. And before I give my talk, I just wanted to mention, Mark, that I worked with Judy Pfeiffer for years, about 30 years now, I guess. And she was of the generation before me, but I'm directly in her lineage because for all that time I've been developing infrared detectors, and that was her specialty along with Bill Forrest. She was very good to me, very gracious. She lent me her secrets when I was wanting to get started. And I was grateful for that. She even wrote a letter unsolicited to Steve Beckwith, who was the director of the Space Telescope Science Institute, when I was coming up for tenure. And she wrote a letter encouraging me to get tenure and saying that I did a job that she thought was very good in establishing a new infrared laboratory, which, by the way, was a competitor of hers. Wow. So that says a lot. You could see that sure she does. Was interested. She was interested in the science. She wasn't interested in quote unquote winning. And that's saying a lot because most of us as scientists, we do need to care about winning in some sense because we do need funding. So I'm going to go ahead and tell you about this James Webb Space Telescope, which I worked on, and it finally launched. And it's really a story about technology, which some of you might already know. And I bet you all know that astronomy in general is a story about technology. The discoveries come from technology. And in fact, I already had Judy Pfeiffer in my talk here. Let me just move the pictures. There we go. Okay, here's, I don't know, can you hear that sound?
Yes, we can hear the sound.
Yeah.
So this is an animation of JWST unfurling, and I put the sound to this because it just seemed appropriate. I don't know if you recognize the sound. Just shout it out if you recognize it.
2001 Space Odyssey.
Yeah.
Thus spake Zarathustra.
So that's the sunshade that's unfurling. So that's an animation that of what was expected to happen on deployment once the telescope got to L2. And by all counts, it appears that that is what happened actually. Unfortunately, there was no sound being played at the time, but it took me a while to sync up the song to make the crescendo right when the secondary boom was extending. I don't know if you noticed that. Here's a little bit about me. I'm a professor in the College of Science at RIT. And I teach in a variety of different departments, but principally for the astrophysical sciences and technology PhD program. So Mark, the students who you mentioned are going to give a talk soon are in the AST PhD program. And in fact, Ben Vaughn is in my center, the Center for Detectors. So I'm the director of the Center for Detectors. We have about 7 professors and 60 people in total when you count the undergraduate and graduate students. Of the 7 professors, 3 of us are astrophysicists like me. And we also have people who do materials development for photonic devices such as detectors. We have someone who does integrated silicon photonics for quantum photonic applications. And then we have someone who is developing detectors for quantum optics. I'm also the director of the Future Photon Initiative, and the CFD, Center for Detectors, is a part of the FPI, and the FPI also has a number of other research centers, including people who make photon sources. So we make detectors, other people make photon sources like LEDs, other people make photonic circuits to manipulate photons, and then there are materials people and theoreticians also in the Future Photon Initiative. I've been at RIT since 2006. Before that, I was at the Space Telescope Science Institute, which operates the Hubble and now operates James Webb Space Telescope. And before that, I was at UCLA, where I designed the optics for the near-infrared spectrograph on Keck. I'm interested in detectors, massive stars, massive star clusters in the galactic center. And last little tidbit about me, I have three daughters, no pets, and a few plants that I haven't killed yet. So here's an outline of my talk. I'll start with fast facts about JWST, its science goals, the history of JWST, which is long and winding by now. And then I want to talk about the key technologies that enable JWST and much of astrophysics. They include segmented mirrors, adaptive and active optics, infrared detectors. And then I'll say something about future missions. So some fast facts about JWST. The launch is in 2021, finally. So every year I had to update that string of characters there whenever I've given this slide to my class. It finally did launch. When I started, the original launch date was 2007. It's a collaboration between US, Europe, and Canada. Has a lifetime of 5 years with a possible extension that depends on how much fuel is left after the station keeping fuel burns that are going to have to happen at L2. It orbits around L2, which is about 1 million miles away, opposite the sun along the Earth-Sun line. And the primary aim is to shed light on our cosmic origins. It'll observe the universe's first galaxies, the birth sites of stars and planets and exoplanets with potential life. And it was named after James Webb, who was the NASA administrator that made sure Apollo happened. He had to constantly fight to get the budget to make Apollo happen in the 60s. It has a 6.5 meter primary, but it's not a monolithic, single monolithic mirror. It's not a single piece of glass or a piece of anything. It's made of segments, because a mirror that big wouldn't fit in the fairing of a rocket. So instead, what we had to do was chop the mirror into hexagonal segments that fit together nicely with small gaps. There are 18 of them. There's a big sun shield, which you saw in that animation. You saw it unfurling, that blocks the light from the sun. And that's important because not only do we not want stray light bouncing around in the telescope, but in addition, light will heat up the observatory and ultimately heat up the instruments. And that's bad because this is infrared. So the wavelength coverage is half a micron to 28 microns. And I realize some of you probably know what this is, but maybe some of you don't. So half a micron is where your eyes are sensitive. And then your eyes can't see past about 0.8. So you notice most of this range is where your eye isn't sensitive, 0.8 to 28 and a half microns. So the wavelengths are longer. So JWST is sensitive to long wavelengths. Look down here at the Hubble Space Telescope. It's sensitive to 0.1 to 2.5. So your eye is sensitive to about 0.4 to 0.8. And so Hubble coincided mostly with what your eye is sensitive to. And the pictures that you see from Hubble, at least the ones in optical light, are mostly what your eye would see if your eye was sensitive enough, which it isn't. JWST has four instruments: the near-infrared camera, the near-infrared spectrograph, the mid-infrared imager, the fine guidance sensor, the near-infrared imaging, I forget what SS is, but the Canadians built that. There's a funny story about that that I could tell you sometime if you ask me. So here's JWST's quote-unquote primary mirror. And this is what I meant when I said that it's segmented. You see, it's not one piece of material. It's 18 individual segments that fit together. And the hexagonal shape for each segment is perfect for being able to fit them close together. Take a look at the Hubble Space Telescope mirror in the lower left. So you can see the relative size. It looks to me like the Hubble mirror is almost the same size as the hole in the center of the JWST mirror. That's the hole for the Cassegrain optical train. Here's a map with a bunch of words on it and lines that you can't see, but you can see that they're there, I bet. Each one of these lines points to some organization that was part of the process of developing, building, and integrating the James Webb Space Telescope. And each of the lines points to a dot here on the map. And you can see in the United States, there are a bunch of dots all over the place. Over here in Europe, you see a bunch of dots. So a whole lot of people contributed to this. It's at least 10,000 people when I've seen it counted. And you see in the caption here, 14 countries, 258 companies, agencies, universities, and et cetera. So this was a big project, and you might have heard about the respective big budget of JWST, and part of the big budget has to do with the fact that it took this many people to build it. You can look at JWST science goals expressed as questions. So these are the questions that we would like to answer with JWST, and as of now, have not been able to do so. So for instance, what did the early universe look like? When did the first stars and galaxies emerge? And Mark was talking about one of the students, the topic would be the early universe and galaxy formation. So that's one of the goals of the James Webb Space Telescope. How did galaxies evolve over time? It looks like galaxies changed some of their properties over the age of the universe, and we want to be able to go back to the very first galaxies. What can we learn about dark matter and dark energy? We know very little about the source of either of these things. And so it's one of JWST's mission to do this. How and where do stars form? They form inside of dust clouds that obscure optical light. So that's why JWST is going to be good at looking into star formation sites, because they're shrouded by dust, but infrared light can penetrate the dust. What determines how many of them form and their individual masses for the stars that form? And how do stars die? And where and how do planetary systems form and evolve? So here's a pictogram that people often show that is meant to demonstrate the evolution of matter in the universe, starting at the Big Bang 13.8 billion years ago on the left, and going all the way to the present day, when you can see on the right side, there are galaxies that have well-defined shape, and they have well-defined shape, and they have familiar shapes. You can see the spirals, like our own Milky Way is a spiral galaxy, as is Andromeda, which I presume most of you have seen. You can also see fuzzy spheres, like M87 is an elliptical galaxy, that's what they're called. And then there are some irregular galaxies too. But if you go back in time, there was a point when we think galaxies were in their infancy, and really there were clumps of matter that you might think of as proto-galaxies. They were all irregular shapes. And eventually they assembled into more orderly shapes like spirals and ellipticals. That's a big topic that I can't spend much time on, but I'll just say that with JWST, we should be able to put together this sort of family portrait as a function of age, going all the way back to a few hundred million years after the Big Bang. Here's an example. This is sort of a tantalizing example of what JWST might see. This is from the Great Observatories survey done with Hubble and with Chandra, and Spitzer was involved. This is the Hubble version of it. And you can see a picture, a swath of sky here, and just about every object in this picture is a galaxy. You notice that there are red ones, they're sort of orange ones. If you look real closely, there are some that are really dark red. I don't know if you can see my mouse very well, but I'm pointing at a red smudge. So that's a galaxy of a few hundred million stars, but it's far away. So we're seeing the light from it as it was in the early universe, and it's redshifted because space is expanding and the wavelengths of the light are being stretched out into the infrared. And so with JWST being sensitive to the infrared, it'll be able to see further back in time to light that's been stretched out even more, even higher redshift to earlier times in the universe. So this is the next topic, star formation. These are real pictures of objects observed with Hubble using the near infrared camera. And they look odd. They don't look like stars. They look fuzzy. And in each case, or at least in most of the cases, it looks like there's some dark line going across them. The one in the lower right, you can see this diagonal line going from the upper right to the lower left. What you're seeing there is the disk of dusty material left over from the star formation process that now is participating in planet formation. And so planets are being formed in this dusty disk of material. And you can see the light creeping out the top and the bottom of the disk. And that's light from the star that's bouncing off of gas on top and below the disk. So the James Webb Space Telescope is going to be able to look at these kinds of objects, but in much higher detail. And so we'll be able to assemble a picture of star formation with much greater precision than we can right now. Here's a neat picture that shows a coronagraphic image of a star and some dots around it. Now, I have to explain this a little bit. You see a star in the middle with 5 points and it's yellow. Now, I know you know this, but I have to tell my students this: stars don't have 5 points. So someone went in there and put this yellow star in the center of that black circle. And what that's meant to indicate is that there is a star located at that spot, but the light from the star is being covered by a circular metal disk at a focal plane. So this is called a coronagraph, because a coronagraph was an instrument originally used to block out the light from the chromosphere of the sun to be able to see the aurora around the sun. And so we still use something like that to block out most of the light from a star so that we can see faint things near it, so that there's not a lot of scattered light. And in this case, you do see faint things near this black circle. You can see dots around it. And this is from Gemini, the Gemini telescope. And take a look at the bottom of the scale, 20 AU. So an AU is the distance between the sun and Earth, an astronomical unit. So 20 AU is, maybe it's the orbit of Neptune or so. And so at the distance of this star, this bar is 20 AU. So these dots are something like 20 AU away from the star. Now take a look at the date in the lower left, 2009, July 31st. Now I'm gonna press a button. Let's see what happens. So these folks went out and observed this system over several years. And hopefully you can convince yourself that those faint dots are orbiting around the big black circle. So those aren't just coincidental stars seen in the background along the line of sight. Those are planets. And so this is direct imaging of planets. So JWST is going to be able to look at systems like this and even go further and take spectra of those planets. And the spectra can reveal the atmospheric composition in the planets. For instance, it would reveal whether there's methane or oxygen or ozone. And those are, some of those things are biomarkers. Now here's an animation, hopefully this will come across to you, that demonstrates coronagraphy, which I explained it in words. I want to show it to you in pictures. Maybe you can hear the sound here. So I don't think this is narrated. So here's light from a star comes into a telescope. You can see the wave fronts are imperfect. They look like potato chips. They should be perfect surfaces, perfect flat surfaces. There's a coronagraphic mask which blocks some of the light in the center. And then there's a Leo stop in the pupil that gets rid of the bad parts of the beam. And then this beam, the bluer beam, that's for an off-axis object like a planet. Okay, the contrast is being pulled up there. This is adaptive optics that's deforming the mirror to get rid of the potato chips. Watch it, watch the potato chips bounce off the mirror. And now when you turn on the adaptive optics, there the adaptive optics is going on and the perturbations are being removed. And now you can see a planet. So it's not easy to understand what you just saw, and it's hard to do it in one talk. There are people who've dedicated their lives to developing that technology. In fact, there are people who've dedicated their whole lives to each slide that I'm showing you. But you can see, my point is that there's a system for filtering light, correcting the wavefront, and blocking the starlight in order to reveal the planet, and it involves a coronagraph. This is one of the many planetary, exoplanetary systems discovered by things like the Kepler space mission. This is called the TRAPPIST-1 system, and the planets there are just cartoon renditions. No one knows what they look like, but they do know the relative sizes, and they do know the relative locations. They're labeled B, C, D, E, F, G, H, et cetera. There are a couple of interesting things about this. You see the color coding? See how the inner region of the TRAPPIST system is colored red, and then there's a green region, and then out in the outskirts is a blue region. Those correspond to where water is in a vapor, liquid, or frozen form. And supposedly life requires liquid water. And some people will argue against that, but let's just presume that's true. That means life would require that a planet would have to exist in a green region in this picture. On the bottom, by the way, is our own solar system. One of the things you'll notice here is that the whole TRAPPIST planetary system fits well down within the orbit of Mercury. And you might say, oh my gosh, if it's so close to its star, all this stuff should be super hot. But look at the star. Well, you can't tell from this picture, but the star has very, very low luminosity. So the green zone, or the so-called habitable zone, is pretty close into the star. You can see for the sun down at the bottom, the green zone here coincides with roughly where Earth is. So water can exist in liquid form on Earth, as we know. So not saying it was aliens, but it was aliens. So we're going to look for aliens with JWST and with other missions in the future. And you might be familiar with the Drake equation. This is Frank Drake over here on the right. And he wrote down an equation to estimate the number of intelligent civilizations in the galaxy that we could communicate with. And it looks like that. Basically, it's just a bunch of coefficients multiplied by each other, like the star formation rate and the number of stars with planets and the number of planets per star and the number of planets that could support life, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And just for fun, I plugged in some numbers and I got 4 alien civilizations, but I haven't seen any yet. I don't know if you guys have seen any. If you have, let me know. Of course, these numbers are highly uncertain. And up until recently, we didn't know the fraction of stars with planets. It could have been 0, except for 1, of course, the sun, but it could have been 0. And I remember in the early 90s, I used to go out and observe with the Lick Chain telescope, the 3-meter, when I was doing my PhD. And you stay up all night, of course, you observe, you go to sleep at maybe 6 or 7 in the morning, wake up at 1 or so, and you have some sort of breakfast lunch combination in the cafeteria, and you bump into other astronomers. And so I used to bump into Jeff Marcy and Paul Butler, and they didn't get to sit at the big table. They had to sit at the little kids table because they were looking for planets around other stars, and serious astronomers didn't do that. So they were thoroughly disrespected. So but I used to go over to the kids table and see what they were doing and ask them what was going on, and they said they're looking for planets, and wouldn't you know it, they found planets. So now we know there are lots of planets around stars. By the way, you can click on these links and go find your own Drake equation. There's another theory that maybe we are the aliens. Maybe life formed somewhere in the universe, and through the process of panspermia, the universe was populated with life. And so there's this idea that maybe we're the aliens. By the way, that picture is of my daughter, Gemma. So don't tell her, though, if you bump into her. Don't tell her that I used her picture. The one on the right is ET. So I asked an astronaut if he saw any aliens, Don Pettit. He's been in space 300 or 400 days, I think the most of any other person. He came to visit RIT and asked me to help him with a project he was doing. And actually, these are my daughters here. And we asked him if there were aliens, and he said no. He said he hadn't seen any. So there you go. So here's the history of JWST development. So in the 80s, people started talking about JWST, but think about that. Hubble hadn't even launched yet, and people were already thinking about the telescope after Hubble. Keep that in mind for my last slides, because I'm going to tell you about the next missions that we're working on, and I am working on those. So in the 80s, people started talking about it. And then there was this committee for what to do after Hubble. And the highest recommendation was to build a large cooled infrared telescope. Sounds familiar. And so in 99, a new project was started called the Next Generation Space Telescope, or NGST. And it was approved with a launch date of 2007 and a budget of $500 million. I'm going to show you something. I can no longer see myself. I wonder why that is. Well, there I am. I'm going to show you something. I shouldn't put it on my background because it'll disappear. You see that? That's my official NGST pin in 2002 when I worked on the mission. And that became called the James Webb Space Telescope. It was very peculiar because it was the first time, there were a couple firsts. It was the first time that a mission was named before it launched, which was strange. Usually a mission has a technical name before it launches. Then when it launches, they name it after a person. So they named it for a person before the launch. And the second strange thing was they named it after an administrator. And that was never done. They had always named these things after scientists. So the instruments and detectors were chosen in 2005, and the fabrication and assembly was complete. Now look at this, look at this. It launched in 2021, and the technology was frozen in 2005. So JWST is 16 years obsolete by the time it launched. And I remember Devin, you say cannot see it. You couldn't see my button? Sorry. Okay.
It might be on my end. Like the screen is now, I was like frozen for a moment, but I think.
Can you see me?
Nope.
Can anyone see me?
I see a screen. There's a screen.
I see you, but you got to slide the participant gallery so that you can actually see the videos. And I did see the button as long as you can see your video feed.
Oh, okay, cool.
I'm going to exit and come back. I think it's me. I'm going to exit.
So everything's okay on my end, I think.
I see the I see the button. Good. I see the presentation.
I can see you and see your presentation. So
okay. I think you're good at this point.
Okay. Right. So what I was saying is JWST launched with 16-year-old technology. And the funny thing is, in the early days, we used to brag about the fact that that wasn't going to happen to us. We were gonna build this telescope using a new method where we'd be able to run to the launch pad at the last day and insert new detectors to take advantage of the new technology. And that didn't happen at all. Instead, we had to freeze the technology to get on with the business of fabricating it. Now, let me continue down this calendar here. 2021 is the launch. So there you go. So as you know, and as I said earlier, technology leads to discovery. And in fact, infrared detectors, which are close to my heart, have led to many Nobel Prizes, such as the Cosmic Background Explorer mission. John Mather won the Nobel Prize for that. And he also is the project scientist for JWST. Infrared detectors played an instrumental role in the discovery of dark energy and also in the discovery of the supermassive black hole in the galactic center. JWST needed brand new technology. So they needed new kinds of infrared detectors in the near and mid infrared. It also needed cryo coolers to cool the instruments down to low temperature, cryogenic electronics, which had never been built before, something called microshutters, which are very strange things. I'll show you a picture of that. Wavefront sensing and control and sun shield materials. So I'm going to talk about three of the technologies. And the first one is segmented mirror telescopes. Now, first I wanted to say that there was a sort of a race to build the biggest mirror technology over the past 100 years. And there were two general ideas. One was to build big mirrors with segmented mirrors. And that was Jerry Nelson's idea at UC Santa Cruz. I knew Jerry, I worked with Jerry on Keck. And then the other person is Roger Angel, who was building 8-meter mirrors and testing them underneath the football field at University of Arizona. His idea is everything should have an 8-meter mirror. That was the biggest mirror he could make in a single piece of glass. And so he went around telling everyone to make 8-meter mirrors. Now, JWST had to be light, so it couldn't afford to use thick mirrors. And if you're going to have one piece of material as a single mirror, it needs to be thick to support its shape. So instead, JWST ended up using segmented mirrors. Here's Jerry next to, now that's not the Keck telescope. That would be really disappointing, wouldn't it? So that's a model of the Keck telescope. Actually, look at the right here. There's a little person. So that's the scale of a person. And this is the real Jerry Nelson here. And he's the one who championed the notion of using segmented mirrors to make the Keck telescope 10 meters across. Here's Roger Angel. And he spread out on top of one of his 8-meter glass mirrors. And he's inspecting it, I guess. So it was too heavy. The monolithic mirrors are too heavy. Now, since Jerry Nelson proved that segmented mirrors work well, they've proliferated around the world and they're used at many telescopes. And take a look at this pictogram, which shows you the profiles of primary mirrors of various telescopes. I want to point out a few of them. Look in the lower left, there's a James Webb Space Telescope. See it? So one of the things you notice right off the bat is that it's bigger than the Hubble, which is right next to it to the right, but it's not that big compared to some of the other telescopes here on the ground. And it's funny because one other thing you'll notice if you look here, you see some segmented mirrors like the Hobby Eberle telescope, the South African Large Telescope, or SALT. But you also see some mirrors which are kind of strange. It looks like individual mirrors, round mirrors, put together in a mosaic. So this is Roger Angel getting people to take 8-meter mirrors and making mosaics out of them. It's kind of a strange idea of a segmented mirror. And you can see that that's what the giant Magellan telescope is going to use in the future here in the middle right. And then there's the European Extremely Large Telescope, which is 40 meters. And in the upper right is the 30-meter telescope, which hopefully will be built soon. In the background, by the way, you can see this faint gray thing, kind of looks like a faint donut. That's, look at the bottom, that's the overwhelmingly large telescope. And that was canceled because it was too overwhelmingly expensive. So that became the European Extremely Large Telescope. And just for good measure, here's a picture of a basketball court on the right and a tennis court in the lower left. So JWST mirrors had to be developed and they were developed through something called the Advanced Mirror System Demonstrator, which was a joint project with the military. You can imagine the military might want big telescopes, but I think they want their telescopes to point down and we want our telescopes to point up. And so the National Reconnaissance Office, NRO, co-funded with NASA, that's AMSD. And two test mirrors were made. One was made of beryllium and one was made of glass, incidentally by Kodak here in town. And in the end, the beryllium won out. And so that's what the JWST mirrors are made of. Here's a picture. And here are two real humans on the bottom for scale. And you can see the mirror is pretty big. So 6.5 meters across. You can also see the secondary boom that's folded up here. So the secondary is up at the top of the picture. And then you can see something protruding in the hole in the middle, and that's the baffling and assembly for the instruments. So light goes through there into the instruments, which hang out the back. Feel free to type in any questions or chime in if you'd like. Here's an interesting picture that shows the trajectory of the mirrors as they were being developed. And you can see the numbers in the circles. That tells you the step number for the development of the mirror. So take a look at circle number one, which is in South Dakota. And that's sitting on an arc that originates in Utah. So I think that's a beryllium mine. So they had to dig up beryllium in Utah and then send it way over here in Ohio, where it was processed, and then down to Alabama for additional work, and then off to California, et cetera. Some of these companies might be familiar to L3, Ball, Northrop Grumman. So basically it has to be processed into slabs and then machined away through a progressive machining process, cryogenically cooled to relieve it of stress. And then it has to be machined again progressively to get the right shape. Then it has to be coated and ultimately gold coated because that has the best infrared reflectivity. So it took a lot to make these mirrors. And by the way, take a look at the trip in the lower part of the diagram through Mexico. See number 15? I think that's the trip to the launch site in French Guiana. So another technology that had to be perfected is adaptive optics, which came out of the Star Wars program. When I teach this to my class, I say Star Wars and they think the movie. Then I always have to remind them that I'm talking about Star Wars, the defense program in the 80s that Ronald Reagan was a big proponent of. And the military developed adaptive optics. And soon after that, the astronomers got a hold of it. And now it's used routinely on the big telescopes. David, you're asking a question. It is MERCAD that's used for most of the range. And then I believe it's arsenic doped silicon to go out to 28 microns. So most of the range is MERCAD it's MERCAD that does it. MERCAD has a variable cutoff. So the people who, two of the big champions of adaptive optic systems who developed are Peter Vizinovich at Caltech and Claire Max. I used to see Claire Max all the time at Lick Observatory when she was installing adaptive optics on the Shane 3-meter when I was doing my thesis. And she had a big crew of people and a whole bunch of hardware. And Peter, the same thing. Here's Peter's team. They're celebrating with the successful adaptive optics implementation on Keck. It used to be, it would take all these people, a whole team, to get adaptive optics working. And now when I go to the telescope, I just tell the telescope operator, engage. And then he turns on the adaptive optics system and it's magic. It takes one person. Here's Claire standing in front of the Shane 3-meter telescope that I use for my thesis. And you see mounted on its side is this laser. And you can see the laser light. That thing creates a false star in the atmosphere. And then by observing that star, the adaptive optic system induces perturbations that are the opposite of the perturbations of the atmosphere in order to effectively remove the atmosphere from the beam. And here's what the atmosphere does to a star. This is Alpha Bootes, I think. And it's a high-speed series of images that show you that the atmosphere is perturbing the starlight. And as you know, given your background, if you look up and see a star blinking, this is what's happening. It's the variations in the index of refraction in the upper atmosphere that's perturbing the beam. Look, this is a cool movie. Look at that. That's adaptive optics on or off, and it's the galactic center. That inset is 1 arc second by 1 arc second. You guys know arc seconds, right? Look at that. Look at that 1 arc second. In the Rochester region, the size of a star is about 2 arc seconds, a blob. And this is as seen on the Keck telescope in Hawaii. So this is what I meant by saying engage. When you tell the telescope operator to turn adaptive optics on, this is what happens. Now, at this point, you might be saying, why do you need adaptive optics in space? The whole idea of adaptive optics is to remove the blurring effects of the Earth's atmosphere. That's true, but it's also necessary in order to correct any fabrication errors or any settling errors in the segmented mirrors, and also to adjust the segmented mirrors with respect to each other. And this is a process called phasing, and it uses what's called wavefront sensing and control. So wavefront sensing was that part of the adaptive optic system that was correcting the potato chips. Remember the perturbed wavefronts that were coming into that movie I was showing you? And there was a deformable mirror. That's called wavefront sensing and control. So the sensing happens when an image is taken of the perturbed star. And then the control happens when the mirror is perturbed to induce the opposite perturbations. So just before I left Space Telescope Science Institute, that was my job, was to work on the deployment procedure for JWST. And this is what you're looking at now, are real images. So these are images that look just like I thought that they were going to look when I was working on this project to make sure that JWST was aligned properly. Now, it's a very strange picture. Take a look at the one on the left. You can see 18 blobs. So each blob corresponds to a pretty bad image of the same star. So it's one star in Ursa Major that JWST looked at when it got to L2, and it took this picture on the left. It's a bunch of blobs. Now, what this means is it means a couple things, but one thing it means is that the secondary is out of alignment because every single one of these stars looks bad. And what do these stars have in common? Because each star is produced by one segment, 18 images from 18 mirrors, and they all look bad in the same way. And that tells us that the secondary is out of alignment. The picture on the right is after the secondary was aligned. And you can see that there's still might be some more work to do because they're not perfect. Now, at this point, you might say, well, we don't want to have 18 pictures of a star. We want one picture of one star. And so those 18 segments are out of alignment. They're intentionally misaligned. This is a procedure for phasing up the telescope, so they call it. And they do the same thing at Keck. When you first sit down at Keck, the telescope operator phases the mirrors, and it's fun. You just sit back and watch. It's automated now. And what the automated system does is it kicks out all the segments in the Keck to produce an image of the star for each segment. And then it tilts the mirrors back to make the star images all overlap onto each other. And eventually it iterates on this until it makes a beautiful image, which is what you see here. So this is the culmination of the deployment procedure and the alignment procedure for JWST. It's an image of a single star. The telescope's looking at a star, we get one image. Now you might look at that and say, that looks kind of nasty. There are these funny spikes coming from it and they're kind of serrated spikes, that's strange. And those are interference patterns. And that's to be expected because there are gaps between the mirrors that, and the mirrors have shape. And so that's the expected diffraction pattern or point spread function. So one of the things about JWST, because it is segmented and the gaps are not small, you expect to see that the point spread function will have these funny artifacts. So I finished talking about mirrors and adaptive optics. So let me move on to infrared detectors. So here's a picture of the galactic center in the V band. So this is where your light, where your eye is sensitive. And it covers a piece of sky that is about 2/3 the diameter of the full moon. And the galactic center is in this picture. And I always tell my students, if you can point to where the galactic center is, I owe you a beer. It's a trick question because in the V band, you can't see any star at the galactic center. There's too much dust between us and the galactic center. So only one out of every trillion photons can make it from the galactic center to the Earth because of all the dust. So it's a trick question. I have to admit, one year, one student actually pointed at where the galactic center is. He got lucky. And to this day, I still owe him a beer. And he reminds me every time. So take a look at the right, picture on the right. It's the same piece of sky. Do you notice something? Do you notice where the galactic center is? It's right down here. By the way, the picture on the left, I don't know what the exposure time was, but it's probably many minutes. On the right, the exposure time is 30 seconds and you see 40,000 stars. So what's the difference on the right versus the left? On the right, it's K-band, so it's 2.2 microns. Oh, and by the way, I made this picture using the Lick 3-meter telescope I showed you at Lick Observatory in 1995. So there's a galactic center. It's easy to find that. In the infrared here in the K band, one out of every 10 photons makes the journey. On the left, it's one out of every trillion. So just about every star you see on the right is actually from an object at the galactic center. Oh, and here's a nice movie that Space Telescope made for me. I went to the animation people. It's one of the benefits of working at Space Telescope. They had huge departments of people that would help you do anything. And I asked them to make me this movie. So this starts as if you're sitting out in your backyard. You can see the profile of the trees. Maybe it looks familiar, although I bet your sky doesn't look this good. This is the Milky Way. And you can see some of the dust covering the light towards the center. And it's centered on the galactic center. But I'm going to press a button. And this is going to change to a movie where we jump out of our lounge chair in our backyard and we put on our infrared glasses and we fly in a spaceship towards the center of the galaxy. You ready? Okay, that's where we jumped out of our chair. We're going towards the center of the galaxy. And then we go infrared right now. Now we go infrared towards the galactic center. I have to tell theorists that this part is an animation. These aren't real data. And I told them to put a Star Trek wobble in the field as if we're in a spaceship or we're kind of loopy. You know what that is? That's a supermassive black hole, 4 million solar masses. And those blue things are young stars. Pretty cool. I didn't think that they were going to make that movie. I told them to make it because I thought that they were going to tell me I was crazy, but they came back and they made it. It's beautiful. So that's what you would see in the infrared. And some of those data before this little funny part represent real images that I took of the galactic center using infrared. Infrared pierced through the dust. Devin wants this movie. Yeah, I think, yeah, sure, I'll give it to you. I think this movie is in various places. I've made a few different versions of it too. Okay, so what am I telling you? I'm telling you the infrared peers through dust so we can see all sorts of stuff like stars forming and the center of the galaxy. And how do we see in the infrared? Well, we use these funny things called infrared hybrid arrays. And these are amazing things. They have many pixels. Originally, infrared detectors had one pixel. You had to make a picture with one pixel. So you would take a picture and then you would write down the number and then move the pixel and then repeat that to make a picture. So soon after that, we had the technology to make arrays of pixels instead of a single pixel. In fact, my thesis advisor used a single pixel to discover the galactic center in the infrared, Eric Becklin. And that's a funny story too. You can ask me about that if you want. Take a look at the picture on the right. You see photons coming into this purple thing from above. That purple stuff is infrared light sensitive material, which could be MERCAD, which is what David was saying, mercury, cadmium, telluride. It could be InGaAs, indium gallium arsenide. It could be InSB, indium antimonide. It could be arsenic silicon. But in any case, it's some material that's not silicon. Okay, and that's a bit of a problem because circuits are made out of metal deposited on silicon. And we have this big industry that use silicon-based circuits to make computer chips and all sorts of circuitry. And so how do we get infrared material shown here in purple to interface with silicon circuits? And the answer is it's pretty nasty. It's taken a long time and a lot of money to make this work. But basically you connect every pixel in the purple thing to an amplifier on the silicon part in this picture. So that means if you have a megapixel device, 1,000 by 1,000 pixel device, that means a million pixels have to be connected with a wire from the purple thing to the readout thing, okay? And the connection isn't quite a wire, it's called an indium bump. So then you have to plop a 5-micron ball of indium a million times on a million sites, and then crunch this purple thing onto the circuit to smash the indium. And that makes a cold weld. And then you have to heat it to reflow it to make it a nice shape and make the connection really good. And then think about this when you cool it down. When you cool it down, the purple thing and the silicon circuit, they contract at different rates. Uh-oh. So then it explodes. So more than once have I been in front of a NASA review board of 50 people because I blew up a detector. They're $1 million each. Each chip's $1 million. In fact, I took the first vacation of my life. I think I might've been 33 years old or so. I took the first vacation of my life, well, my professional life. And I was in Italy on the Amalfi Coast on a beach. And my cell phone rang because a detector exploded in my laboratory. And it was a JWST $1 million detector. So I had to fly back. And we had to meticulously at the 1 second level for days figure out what happened in the lab and the status of all parts of the system. And I had to go through a NASA review board, failure review board, like the Challenger explosion review board. And I had to explain what happened and how we would make sure it didn't happen again. Now, one of the problems is we never figured out what happened. but we found ways to improve certain things about our system. So I thought we were done. And within 2 or 3 months, I blew up another detector. And so this was very bad. It was sort of career ending level. So I had to sit through another review board. But over the next year, 19 detectors around the world exploded. So then we took it as a source of pride that we were the first ones with meticulous metrology about the operating conditions of the detector. We were the first ones to find out that there was a fabrication flaw in these detectors made for JWST. And so that's good, right? Because we were able to find out something was wrong. And the company had to go back and figure out what was causing the problem. And it turns out that there's a problem with institutional memory. It takes 174 fabrication steps to make one of these detectors. That's why they cost $1 million each. They found out that some guy inserted a step, like, I don't know, step 43, 15 years earlier. And recently, another guy made an innovation where he added a part of the process that was incompatible with the step from the other guy from 15 years earlier. And that led to this failure. It's a very tricky business. By the way, in mixing two different materials, the purple infrared material and the silicon material, that's called a hybrid construction. So infrared arrays are called hybrids. So here are some people who are infrared detector pioneers. Don Hall, who was my mentor, he was the director of the Institute for Astronomy at the University of Hawaii. He worked at Space Telescope years earlier, and he was one of the kings of infrared detectors. In fact, when I started my lab, I was told I need to go out and I had to kiss his ring. I had to go out and ask his permission to be in the family because I was interfering with his business. So I flew 14 hours from Baltimore to Hawaii, and I drove to his house up on the hills above the ocean, and I sat down at a table in his backyard and I had lunch with him. And that's when I asked him how he would feel if I was going to start an infrared detector lab. And the theme from The Godfather was playing in the background, or at least in my head. And I thought I might not be able to get out of there. So he said it was okay, and he supported and wanted to help me to start an infrared lab. This is another example, like Judy Pfeiffer, where these are real scientists, and they want to support the advancement of science. It's not just about them. Don Hall's specialty was MERCAD, mercury, cadmium, telluride. There it is, at University of Hawaii. Al Fowler was another guy who was very helpful to me. I hired him at one point to help me establish my lab. And his specialty was INSBE, indium antimonide. And he was at the University of Arizona. Judy Pfeiffer at the University of Rochester, they were champions of INSBE, and they used the INSBE arrays early on to look at the galactic center in the late 80s. And her partner was Bill Forrest. And Bill and Judy always helped me. And these are the pioneers of these infrared detectors. Kadri Viral led the Rockwell Science Center, which later became known as Teledyne. And Teledyne were the ones who won the competition to make the JWST detectors. So I work with Kadri to this very day. He retired and then he went to work at another company, and he and I are now proposing the largest infrared detector ever made. And we just asked, I just asked NSF for $2 million to start that project. And Alan Hoffman, who the story goes, Alan was at Raytheon and he had some detectors that were for military purposes. And now this is a story. Now, don't tell anyone I said this. I don't know if it's true. I don't want to get arrested. But the story is Alan took a few of these detectors when no one was looking. And then he flew to Rochester and he dumped a few in Judy's desk. And he sort of whispered out of the side of his mouth for her to go look in her desk. And those were 58 by 62 pixel devices, 58 by 62. I had one of those. This is back in 1990. I had one of those, and we used to call them tank killers. You know why? Because they were built to kill tanks. And if you put them under a microscope and look at the edge on the ceramic, you see a picture of a tank. and then there's a missile coming into the tank. So these are one-time use detectors. They're put in the front of a missile to find tanks and kill them. So here are the people who really were pioneers developing these detectors. Here are a couple examples of detectors. On the left is a detector in my laboratory. This happens to be an H4RG, which is a Hawaii 4K by 4K device with reference pixels and a guide mode. That's what H4RG means. And you can see the little name on it, -10, that's 10 micron pixels. So we were the first ones in the world to get this device. And this is very, very much like the JWST detectors. We also got many JWST detectors, but this picture, just to be truthful, is very similar. It's made by Teledyne. It's about the same size, but it's a little bit different. On the right, you can see some Raytheon detectors. And there's a little ruler that shows you how big they are. And there's a penny there. And the one on the right is, that's a 2K by 2K. And the one on the lower left is a 1K by 1K. The one above it is a 256 by 256. And the one on the top is a Certif. So the Certif became known as Spitzer. So that's a 256 by 256. Anyway, this is what they look like. I mean, $1 million seems like a lot for those things, but that's how much it costs. Now for JWST, a few other interesting technologies supporting detectors had to be invented. So this is the sidecar ASIC. ASIC means application specific integrated circuit. So basically it's all the electronics you need to run a detector and process its data in one chip. So that had never been done before for infrared detectors. And a guy named Marcus Lusa was the designer at Teledyne, and he made this. And it operates, the other thing is it operates at 40 Kelvin. So this is an extremely complex chip, as complex as a Pentium, although they don't call them Pentiums anymore, but a CPU, and it operates at 40 Kelvin. Mark's asking, what's the largest detector you're making? So we propose to do a 4K by 6K, so that's a rectangular one, and it's based on a $5 million development program that I've run for 6 years at RIT with funding from NSF and NASA. So we just proposed to take our knowledge that we developed, make a 4K by 6K. If it works, we're going to propose to make 24 of those. So 24 4K by 6K detectors in a 4x6 mosaic. And so it'll be a square focal plane. And then we want to put that in a telescope at the South Pole because it's very cold there. And that's good for reducing the thermal background. So wish us luck. The NSF is reviewing that proposal now. Here's another funky technology called microshutters. And the main picture here is you can see a mosaic or array of microshutters. And in the upper right inset, you see a zoom in. It's a very strange thing. Look at it. It looks like a bunch of little trap doors. And you can see that the trap door is connected to the rest of it with a tiny little island. Between it, and then you see something over here, it looks like a pencil or something, and it's pushing down on this mirror, or not mirror, door. So these doors are called shutters because they can open and close. And they're opened by applying a voltage, and that lets light go through the locations that are open. And then when you want to reset them to close, there's a magnet that you sweep past them, and they all go. They all come back up, okay? And the idea is you point this thing in the focal plane of an instrument on JWST, you point it at a field of many objects, let's say a dozen galaxies. And you only open the shutters that are coincident with the light from each galaxy. So now it's only the light from the individual galaxies going through individual shutters. And behind this, you put a spectrograph. So now this is a multi-object spectrograph. And traditional spectrographs only allow you to take a spectrum of one object at a time. And who wants that? You have this beautiful, big, two-dimensional detector with 4 million pixels per detector. And you're only going to take one spectrum of one object. That just makes a trail of light along the width of the detector. But all the other pixels are unused. So the real way to do it is to use this multi-object spectrograph. And this had to be developed for JWST. And this was the winner of a competition. The competing technology was micro mirrors instead of micro shutters. Micro mirrors are used in projectors. Maybe you know that, maybe you've seen those before. And RIT is continuing to develop micro mirrors in the Center for Detectors, in my center under Zora Ninkov, Professor Ninkov. Here is a faked up format of spectra from many objects using these micro shutters. And you can see a bunch of horizontal smears, and each one of those corresponds to light from a different object. So it's a way to get multiple object spectra on the detector. It's gonna be a bear to calibrate that, but people are on it. Now I'm gonna switch gears just a tiny little bit here. I'm gonna go back in time to 2002 when I was a young man and I was lured into working on JWST because it was gonna launch in 2007. And I think I was lied to. So at that time, I proposed to be the lab that would do the comparative testing of JWST prototype near infrared detectors. Oops, sorry. In a new thing called the IDTL, the Independent Detector Testing Laboratory, and I was the founding director of this. And it was at the Space Telescope Science Institute and the Johns Hopkins Observatory. It was a joint laboratory. And I'm just going to show you a few slides from a report that I presented to the near-infrared camera team to help them and NASA pick which of the two competing detectors would be chosen for JWST, the detectors made by Raytheon or the detectors made by Teledyne. And here's some of our team, and here are some of the team members, Bernie Rauscher and Mike Reagan in particular, were the co-founders of the lab, and there are many other people who contributed. So I'm over here on the right, and you can see this guy in the middle, Eddie. Eddie standing in front of a green machine, and you can see a bunch of cables and stuff. So this was one of our pictures we took when we built the lab. And someone told us we looked like a boy band, like Eddie and the Cruisers. So we made an album cover. We never made the album though. We just got as far as the cover, and this was our new laboratory. Here's another picture of the system. Remember that green machine in the back there? Here's a close-up of it. And oh, by the way, can you see my background in here, my Zoom video? You see a machine just like it, except it's orange. It's RIT orange. That thing behind me, it's called a Doer, is a duplicate of the green thing. So I designed the green thing at Space Telescope with some of the people you're looking at. And then I took the designs with me and I went to RIT and I made another one. And so what you can see here is an entrance window on the right. See that? That's a calcium fluoride window. Light goes in. And then inside is a vacuum cryogenic system. So it's pumped down to about 100 nanotor. So that's like 1/10 billionth of an atmosphere inside. And then it's cooled down to as low as 24 Kelvin. Up on top here, you can see electronics. So we were using the standard electronics, and you can see it's pretty bulky. And remember that chip, that ASIC I showed you? Marcus Lusa built that chip to replace this whole thing. And then over here on the left, you can see a vacuum hose sucking out the air from the green can, and then helium lines, which makes it cold inside. So this is a system that we built with the specific purpose of testing competing detectors in a head-to-head comparison. And the reason we won the grant from NASA to do that is because up until then, there were labs that ran one kind of detector and there were labs that ran the other kind of detector. And when they published results, the problem is that there were different labs making different measurements using different techniques. So we said we were going to build one system, one set of people, one experimental procedure, one set of software, one set of electronics, and put the two detectors in one after another and do identical tests. Okay? Here's a cross-section of the system. I don't know if any of you are optical engineers or have done anything with mechanics before, but on the left here is a focal plane outside the window. And the black lines represent rays. So this is ray tracing. and it hits a flat mirror, and the rays diverge. It hits an Offner, a one-to-one Offner, which is an all-metal system. It's a secondary, and the Offner again, the tertiary, into a flat and onto the detector here. If you can see my mouse, I'm pointing at the detector, which is right here. And it sits inside this orange thing, which is a light-type box. And this was a very, very difficult engineering task because we had to measure a small number of photons, ultra-low background. And the problem is the outer shell of the Dewar, see the outer shell here? It's the green part. That outer shell's at room temperature. And if you use the black body equation at room temperature, you find that it generates 10 to the 23 photons per second. So we have to block 10 to the 23 photons per second from hitting the detector. And so this red box had to be light tight. Now there's some, and what's worse is we had other experiments where we wanted to let light in. And we had other experiments where we wanted to block light. So we had to have a system that allowed for a movable filter wheel shown in blue here and blue here. And we had to be able to externally command a cryogenic filter wheel to turn to alternately block light from the detector or put filters in front of the detector. So let no light hit and then block the light. So that was difficult, but we did it. Here are some of the serial numbers for the devices that we tested in the timeline. H1RG is Hawaii, these are Teledyne. And then SB is Santa Barbara, which is Raytheon. And the vendors were both told to give us home run devices. Those are supposed to be their best devices. And here are some pictures of an Air Force target that we took with the various devices. And I'm not going to show you the measurements that we made except for this one. So this is signal versus time. And each dot represents the mode, which is like the mean, of 4 million pixels. So we're measuring the signal of all the pixels and taking the average versus time. Each of these dots, there are 250 dots. And the amount of time this took is 2,500 seconds. The scale here is analog to digital units, which are arbitrary units that come out of an analog to digital converter. And you don't need to be concerned with them. The only thing I'll say is this corresponds to a very, very tiny accumulation of charge. And this is in the dark. So if it's in the dark, you should expect the slope to be zero. It's not zero, so that's dark current. So detectors themselves generate charge. It's called dark current. It's not good. It adds noise. So you would want the lowest dark current possible. The point of this though is that the dark current's insanely low. It's like 1,000 times lower than the original detectors that were made. And it's even 100 times lower than even the best state-of-the-art detectors at the time. So Teledyne did an amazing job. They were called Rockwell before. Teledyne did an amazing job at making these detectors. And that's why they won the competition. Here's me and my colleagues who won the NASA Space Act Award for development of these detectors. There's Don Hall, my mentor. That's me in the glasses. Bernie Rauscher, my partner. Scott Hubbard, who is the director of NASA Ames Research Center. And Kevin, I'm forgetting his name. It's not Kevin Garnett because that's the basketball player. It's Garnett is his last name. There's Marcus Lusa, the developer of the ASIC. There's Majid, who's the material scientist. And then there's, I think his name is Sean. He was Don Hall's assistant. And there's Craig McCrite, who was the head of detectors at NASA Ames Research Center. So basically, NASA needed a bunch of inventions. I told you that. One of them was in detectors. And I didn't invent the detectors, but I was part of the process of measuring their properties in order to refine the development of them. And for that, I, along with the other people in this picture, won this Space Act Award. Okay, I'm going to wrap up here. There are future missions. The Roman telescope is going to be launched soon in 2027. It uses a former spy satellite that was kept at Harris. In a storage bin in Harris, and the NRO gave, the spy agency gave NASA one of them. And so that's going to launch. There's something called the Large Ultraviolet Optical Infrared Survey Telescope. That's going to replace the James Webb Space Telescope. And I was the chair of the detector working group for LUVOIR. this is what I was saying about when I was going to talk about future missions. So we're starting now. JWST just launched, and we're starting now to build its replacement. So I'm all the way back in 1999 again. I was also the detector scientist for the high definition imager instrument team. There's something called HAPEX, which is the Habitable Exoplanet Observatory. And that's meant to find Earth-like planets around sun-like stars. So to look for signatures of water and oxygen. So that's the end. I want to stop there. I think I went over. I'm sorry, but had a few questions in between.
No big deal, Don. You're fine. You're fine.
Good.
So Don, when you're looking at planetary spectrum, how far away can we determine spectra for these planets that we would see with these JWST?
Right. So let me give you an example. An Earth-like planet around a sun-like star at 10 parsecs has a magnitude of 30. And you guys know what magnitudes are.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So it's a factor of 100 in flux for every 5 magnitudes, right? So if your eye faint limit is 6 magnitudes, so 6 to 30 is like 25, right? 25 is 5, 5 times 5. So that's 10 to the 10. 10 billion times fainter.
Yeah.
So I don't know if I did that math right, but it seems about right.
Yeah, that's very close, yes.
Yeah, now the trick there actually, you know, it to add insult to injury or to add some salt to the wound, not only is it difficult to see 30th magnitude things, but it's sitting next to something that's 10 billion times brighter, namely the star that it's next to. So you need to build a coronagraph that nulls the light of the star by 10 billion times. And then after that's all said and done, you need something sensitive enough to see the planet that's left over. Then let's really stick our thumbs in our eyes. Then we're going to take the light and spread it in a spectrum. That's the worst thing you can do. The precious little light you have, you're now going to spread it in a spectrum. So the answer is we can't see very far because that was only 10 parsecs, right? So we can't see very far. It's very difficult. But you can see that there are people going crazy, straining themselves to do this, us included. We got $1 million from NASA 2 years ago to develop the optical detector to find Earth-like planets. And the detector we're using counts single photons. You can't get any better than counting single photons. And there's no other detector that does it except for the one that we have. And the one that we have was invented by Eric Fossum. Do you know him? Does anyone know him? So Eric Fossum developed and invented the camera that's in your cell phone in 1992. So he began developing a single photon detector about 5 years ago, and I saw what he was doing and I knew it was gonna work. And I went to him and I said, we gotta get that in space. And so NASA gave us $1 million, and our first cool down of that detector was today.
Oh, cool.
Well, it is cool in a sense because we were cooling it down, yeah. But guess what? We had to warm it up because a bias current was wrong.
Oh, dear.
So poor Justin, my head engineer, had to warm it up, and we're going back down Monday because he fixed the bias current problem. So we have two detectors we're developing. There's a single photon counting detector in the optical. That's for the optical. And then we're developing the 4K by 6K pixel device. You know what we called it? It's called Hellstar. And we call it Hellstar because I was watching a movie. It's a very inappropriate movie, so I highly recommend it. It's called The Wrong Missy, and it has a character in it called Hellstar. And I was watching the movie with someone, and she turned to me and she said, oh my God, you should try to name a project Hellstar. And she said, I'm sure you can't do it. I said, hold on. It took me 5 minutes. So it's mercury cadmium telluride. That's the H. Extremely large layout sensor technology for astrophysics research. So I just proposed a $2 million project to NSF to build Hellstar. And my industrial partner is Raytheon. And I just started sending them documents on Hellstar, And after about a month, I talked to the lead engineer and I said, does anyone realize I'm calling this Hellstar? Like, when are they going to tell me I can't call it this? And he said, oh, no. It's been adopted company-wide. They like the name. And they said, you got to remember, we make Hellfire missiles.
Okay.
I said, oh, okay. You know, it fits with the brand, right?
Yeah. Tank killers, Hellstars.
Yeah. 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 In fact, if I could show you, I'm gonna stop sharing for a second. And I'm going to show you a picture that I took with the development prototype for Hellstar, okay? So the prototype development program over the past 5 years, where I got the $5 million from NASA and NSF, that was called the Saturn Project, which also stands for something, but we affectionately call it Satan because Satan gave birth to Hellstar. So I'm going to show you the image that we took with the prototype for Hellstar. So that's an infrared detector, 1K by 1K. And wow. So that's what we're gonna use to make the 4K by 6K device.
Nice. Infamous.
I got a question. You have liquid coolants on the James Webb.
Yeah, but it's a closed cycle cooler. So the cryogens don't run out.
Was it like liquid nitrogen or?
Oh, it's helium. It's helium. Oh. Did you see the picture where I had, you don't see it behind me easily, but where I had the green doer and I had something called helium lines. So that's helium in a hose that gets pumped into the expansion valve in the refrigerator attached to the doer, and the gas expands, it collects heat, and then it gets pumped back down the return line into a compressor, which dumps the heat in the water line at RIT, and then it recompresses the gas and pumps it back to the doer. It's a closed cycle, so you don't run out of cryogens. By the way, I want to tell you something funny about that. If you use liquid cryogens at RIT, they charge you an arm and a leg, okay, because it costs a lot of money. But they don't know how to charge me for electricity. So I just changed everything from liquid cryogens to compressors. Don't tell them. To compressors that each consume 5,000 watts. So I have 3 5,000 watt compressors running continuously. And I have no liquid cryogens and they don't know how to charge me.
Okay. I just wanted to ask also for the IR detectors, the anti-tank, that sounds a lot like the Javelin missile instead of being used against the Russian main battle tanks.
Yeah. A lot of missiles that didn't even have that capability were retrofitted with infrared systems.
They claim they're very expensive, the Javelins.
Yeah, well, yeah, all that stuff is, I mean, you remember in the Iraq war, you would see all these videos on the news every night of someone going over a bridge and then a big bomb or something. And you notice that was in thermal infrared. It you could see that hot things were glowing, like people were glowing. You see it in video games too, right? You go when you're on those gunner ships, you can see the thermal infrared, and that's what these detectors see.
I have a quick question. So one of your slides said that the anticipated lifespan of James Webb is 5 years. What do you guys hope it will, how long do you hope it will last?
It seems that the big limit is the fuel to keep the thing around L2. I have a video, I won't show it to you because I've already spent too much time, but there's, the JWST spins around L2 and it constantly needs some fuel to make sure that it's stable and it doesn't float away from L2. As soon as that fuel's gone, I think it floats away. So the 5-year mission is what we were told when we were doing development, because you have to tell people, you have to tell an engineer how long it's supposed to last before it breaks. If you don't, their heads will explode. If you don't, they'll engineer the most perfect thing ever that costs infinity. So you have to tell them, make sure your thing doesn't break for 5 years, and then it can break. And then an engineer knows how bad to make it or how good to make it.
They need constraints.
you have to have it, right? And so I was in endless meetings at NASA because I played in the in-between hat. I had a hat in between the scientists and the engineers because I was a scientist and did engineering. And we were hired as system scientists, a space telescope. And I was constantly having to tell the scientists, no, you need to, you can't tell them, make it the best you can. That's what scientists say. You have to tell them when to stop working. And so our number was 5 years. So we all knew 5 years. And we all winked at each other, like, let's try to make it better. And so what I heard was they did so well on the trajectory, on the launch, that they conserved so much fuel that they can go 15 years.
Cool. Just in time for Luvar.
Cool. Yeah, Luvar will take over, hopefully.
Other questions?
No.
Well, the engineer jokes. The engineer makes it work longer so they don't get blamed.
If you guys want a tour of the Center for Detectors, let me know. You can email me or
We'll take you up on that. I'll shoot you a note.
Or
that would be fun to do.
Yeah, could you post your email in the chat, please? Thanks.
Okay, hold on 1 second. You can email or text, and you can come in individually or as a group as you'd like, and I could give you a tour of some of what you see behind me.
That would be cool to do. Thanks, Don.
Yeah.
Well, if there aren't any other questions, thank you so much, Don. Appreciate it very much with your talk and a very informative, incredible information about detectors. I was blown away. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Yeah, it was great to be here. But by the way, am I able to access this recording or is?
Yes. Yes. I'll send out a link. I'll load it up to our YouTube page where we have our recorded meetings over the last couple of years, and I'll send you a link to it.
Okay. Thanks, guys.
Super.
We'll see you.
Thank you so much.
Yep. Bye.
Thank you so much. Fantastic.
Thank you. Very good.
Thank you. Thanks.
Bye.
And that's it for us for this evening. Any other questions, concerns, or comments you guys would like to make? Or chat? Mm-hmm.
I do have a question, actually. Yeah. So I'm kind of a remote member. I grew up in Rochester, but I live in LA. So Rochester Fest.
Yes.
So kind of, I'm a new member. So kind of tell me what that's about.
So Rochester Fest is basically an opportunity for us as members of the astronomy section to get together, have a little get together in the summertime. So typically it starts out on a Friday night. We'll have, we'll get together. If it's clear, we'll do some observing. But before that, we will sit down and we'll do a little astro music trivia where we'll play little snippets of music with the astronomy related things in them. We'd have to identify the songs, who performed them and what year they were performed. And we'll do this as three teams of people. And then after that, we'll play that for about an hour. Then we'll play Astro Jeopardy, where one of our members will make a whole Jeopardy board of questions. And again, there's three teams playing Astro Jeopardy. And that's our pre Rochester Fest evening, the Friday night. And hopefully, if it's clear, we do some observing after that. It just occupies our evening until it gets dark out.
Okay. And this is all at Ionia?
It's all in Ionia.
Okay.
And then on Saturday, some people start earlier in the day to get things set up, but we'll have, starting at noon, we'll have several talks and activities, all astronomy or science related during the day, some kids activities. Sometimes there's rocket launching. Sometimes we do a fossil search in a big sand pile. or we'll do some other astro projects for kids as well as things for adults. So we'll have several talks during the day. And then at the end of the day, we have a barbecue dinner and done by one of our extraordinary barbecuers that's a member of our club. And then we'll have a keynote speaker that will speak on a subject to tie up the evening. The following day, we'll do a little cleanup. Last year, we had planned to do an in-person one and we could not, but we did have a fabulous speaker in Alexei Filipenko, who spoke for us, who ended up doing a virtual talk for us, which was very fascinating. So that was that's Rochester Fest.
Okay, thank you so much. And I'll see if I can arrange a family trip at that time.
We'd love to have you. Love to see you. Where are you at, David?
I live near Pasadena, California. Okay. Yeah, I grew up in Rochester and may end up back there. I'm now retired, so I may end up back there at some point because most of my family is there. But great. Thank you so much for the overview. I appreciate it.
Absolutely. It's a great place to be in the summertime anyway.
It is. It's I love it half of the year.
That's right. That's right. So do we. Tony and Paula mentioned we have door prizes and raffles for that event as well at Rochester Fest. So there's plenty of things to win and look at. We'll have a little auction of equipment and stuff that we have, excess equipment. It's a fun thing to do. And sometimes there's a Shatner vocal impression, yes. Any other questions?
This is Dave Bishop.
Hey, Dave.
We still don't have a speaker for Starfest. And I am still fishing. Okay. And I sent Jim Bell, who really owes us a phone call, a couple of emails, and I've been able to get a hold of him.
Okay.
However, another professor at RIT recommended a person called Ryan McDonald, who does work on extrasolar planets. Has anybody else heard of him?
I don't know that I have, no.
All right. Just a thought. If anybody has any ideas for a speaker for Starfest, please let me know.
All right. And David, your email is in the on the Rochester page, the website?
Yeah, I'll put it in the chat.
Okay, perfect. Do that, please. Thanks.
Well, it's good to see you guys tonight.
Mark, there will still be an open house on Sunday.
Yep.
Just so people know that are on here, we may not open any of the observatories if it's raining or anything. But if somebody hasn't been to the site or hasn't been to the site lately and they'd like to come and see stuff, we can at least let them into the observatories, even though we're not going to open them up.
Yep. Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. So I don't think we're going to do the Messier Marathon tomorrow night. So don't stay up late thinking we're going to do something. It does not look at all promising tomorrow. But if there's an opportunity in the next week to do something, I'll let you know. I'm going to try to do if it's at all possible, try to do the Mies supernova observation if there's a clear night, because we could do it early in the evening and it's not something that we'd have to take all night to do. So it would be some kind of evening thing that we could do.
The supernova you're looking at has turned bright red and is now magnitude 16.5.
Oh, that's dimming quickly. Okay.
Yeah. And we've got a very much a dearth of bright supernovas right now.
Yeah.
We had a bunch of Mag 11s at the beginning of the year, and now we're down to Mag 15 and 16s.
Yeah. Now we could do 15, 16, but once we get dimmer than that, it's pretty difficult. It might be difficult to get some resolution. We can get pretty good resolution on the Mies telescope. 15, 16 is actually still fairly bright. We'll see. The students take
did I show well. You guys the picture of the supernova in the ring net in the ring galaxy?
I think you did last meeting. Yeah.
Yes. I'm sorry. I've actually done a couple of talks for different clubs.
Very good. Very good. All right, folks. Well, thanks for spending your Friday night with us. I thought Don Feiger was very entertaining, very funny. So thanks to Don for the talk. And I'll see if we can arrange something official with the astronomy section to do a little tour of his Center for Detectors. That looks like that could be pretty interesting. Maybe we'll work something out for that. All right.
That'd be great, Mark.
Yeah, that would be fun. Bye. That would be fun. Well, thanks everybody for coming. Have a good night.
Yep.
Thanks, Mark.
Hey, Mark.
Have a nice weekend.
Nice job.
Hang out for a moment, Mark, I want to ask you a quick question.
Sure, no problem. Hey, Devin. Good to see you. Thanks for coming. Say hi to Mike for us.
I will not be around on April 1st. I'm going to be on vacation. I'm going down to South Carolina and Savannah, Georgia.
Okay, fantastic. Enjoy.
So I guess we'll let Tom take over the technical.
Yes.
So, and hopefully he won't over-engineer it this time.
No, exactly.
But I did want to let you know when you, I was thinking the meeting might be the following Friday, but I'll be out of town. So.
All right. We'll work it out. All right. Enjoy your time.
Yeah. It's going to be fun. Charleston, South Carolina and Savannah.
Cool.
So it'll be very cool. Awesome. Very cool. All right. Thanks a lot. Right. Take care.
Thanks, Jackie. Mm-hmm. Take it easy. Bye. Good night, everybody.